Hello everyone, today we will discuss some prescriptions and CCR. Now we will begin with drug therapy for urinary tract infection. Our main goals for treatment of urinary tract infection is to eradicate the infecting microorganism and to provide symptomatic relief by altering the pH of urine. Generally in UTI infection, urine become acidic. So to provide symptomatic relief, we can give alkaline mixture or giving phenazopyridine. Here phenazopyridine, it acts as a painkiller in urinary tract. It does not treat cause of urinary irritation, but it can help to provide symptomatic relief in UTI infections. It usually takes 3 times daily after meals. So for to provide symptomatic relief, we can give alkaline mixture or giving phenazopyridine. Then our next goals are to prevent and treat recurrence and to identify and treat predisposing factors. So these are the goals for treatment of urinary tract infection: to eradicate the infecting microorganism, to provide symptomatic relief by altering the pH of urine or by giving phenazopyridine, and to prevent and treat recurrence, to identify and treat predisposing factors. Generally, UTI infection is a common disorder in all ages and in both genders. A healthy and normal urinary tract infection generally resistant to infection. However, for anatomical reason, the female lower urinary tract is more susceptible to infections. Now we will see the general principle of UTI therapy. First one is in acute urinary tract infection. Here in acute urinary tract infection, physician should be given appropriate drug as soon as the urine is collected for bacteriological examination. When the drug sensitivity report of pathogen grown are available, then another drug can be substituted for the first one if necessary. Otherwise, we can continue the drug. Okay. So here in acute UTI infection, physician must give appropriate antibiotic as soon as the urine is collected for bacteriological examination. Then in chronic UTI infection, mixed infection is more likely, and concomitant renal failure may modify drug therapy. In such cases, there is no desperate hurry to start treatment before the case is completely investigated. Okay, it must be noted that the significant infection is in the tissue and not in the luminal urine alone. That means for successful treatment, the drug must achieve adequate concentration in the tissue as well as in the urine. And also the drug must be used in adequate doses and for adequate period to stop reinfection. Then investigations of cases of urinary tract infection. Urine obtained by Meerschaum technique or by suprapubic bladder puncture is examined bacteriologically and isolated microorganism tested for its sensitivity to various bacteriological drug. So these are the general principle of urinary tract infection therapy. Then drug using UTI infection. There are so many drugs which we can use in UTI infection: bacteriostatic agent, bactericidal agent, and urinary antiseptics. Bacteriostatic agents such as sulfonamide, doxycycline, and nitrofurantoin can be used in UTI infection. Then bactericidal agents such as cotrimoxazole, ampicillin, extended spectrum penicillin, aminoglycosides, chloroquinolone, cephalosporin, and azithromycin. These are the bactericidal agents which we can use in UTI infection. Then urinary antiseptics. These urinary antiseptics act as an antibacterial agent only in the urinary tract. For example, nitrofurantoin and methinamine, mandelate and nalidixic acid. These are the urinary antiseptic which we can use in UTI infection. So these drugs can be used for UTI infection. Bactericidal agents like sulfonamide, doxycycline and nitrofurantoin. Bactericidal agents are extended spectrum penicillin, cotrimoxazole, aminoglycoside, fluoroquinolone, cephalosporin, and azithromycin. And urinary antiseptics like nitrofurantoin, methanamine, mandelate, and nalidixic acid. So these drugs can be used for treatment of urinary tract infection. Among bacteria causing UTI infection, E. coli is considered as the most predominant cause of both community and nosocomial UTI infection. Now coming towards prescription for urinary tract infection which is caused by E. coli. Now the prescription, this is a prescription for urinary tract infection due to E. coli. For urinary tract infection, we give tablet norfloxacin 400 mg twice daily for 7 days in complicated cases. And for mild UTI infection, we give norfloxacin 400 mg twice daily for 3 days along with tablet paracetamol 500 mg twice daily till fever subside with alkaline mixture 2 tablespoons 3 times daily for 5 days and plenty of oral fluid follow up after 3 days. So this is the prescription for urinary tract infection. There are so many drugs are available for treating UTI infection. Now the question will come in your mind, that is why norfloxacin is a drug of choice? Because norfloxacin, it get more concentrated in urine than other drugs. And it has excellent activity against gram-negative microorganisms like E. coli, Klebsiella, Salmonella, Shigella, Proteus. That's why norfloxacin is a drug of choice in UTI infection because it gets more concentrated in urine and has excellent activity against gram-negative microorganism. It is administered in a dose of 400 mg twice daily for 7 days. Okay, this norfloxacin, it belongs to class fluoroquinolones. Okay, fluoroquinolone group of antibiotic have dual mechanism. Okay, in gram-negative microorganism, they inhibit DNA gyrase enzyme. Okay, DNA gyrase, it is also known as topoisomerase 2 enzyme. Okay, thus this will prevent the replication of bacterial DNA during bacterial growth and reproduction. Okay, so this fluoroquinolone group of antibiotic inhibit gram-negative bacteria. In gram-negative bacteria, they inhibit topoisomerase 2 enzyme. This will prevent replication of bacterial DNA during bacterial growth and reproduction. Okay, here you should remember, in gram-negative bacteria, fluoroquinolone inhibit topoisomerase 2 enzyme. In gram-positive bacteria, fluoroquinolone group of antibiotic inhibit topoisomerase 4 enzyme. And this will interfere with the separation of replicated chromosomal DNA into the respective daughter cell during cell division. Okay, so this is the mechanism of action of fluoroquinolones. Fluoroquinolones inhibit DNA gyrase enzyme. In gram-negative bacteria, they inhibit topoisomerase 2 enzyme. And in gram-positive bacteria, they inhibit topoisomerase 4 enzyme. Okay, then we also give tablet paracetamol 500 mg twice daily for fever. Then here, why alkaline mixtures are added in UTI therapy? Because here the growth of E. coli is optimum at pH 5 to 6. In UTI infection, generally urine become acidic. Okay, so the growth of E. coli is optimum at pH 5 to 6 and its growth can be inhibited at pH below 5.5 and above 7.5. Okay, after alkalization of urine, the pH of urine become more than 7.5. So the growth of E. coli is inhibited at pH 7.5 and shows optimum antibacterial activity. Okay, alkanization also helps to reduce irritation of urinary tract. Alkanization is achieved by the administration of 2 g of sodium bicarbonate, that is half tablespoon sodium citrate or potassium citrate 4 to 6 times a day. Okay, the fluid intake should be liberal as the frequency as frequent emptying of the bladder, which help to reduce bacterial count in the urine. So the patient should take adequate oral fluid in UTI infection. Okay, the fluid intake should be liberal as the emptying of the bladder, which helps to reduce bacterial count in the urine. That's why patient should take adequate oral fluid in UTI infection. Now coming towards typhoid fever, treatment for typhoid fever. Typhoid fever is also known as enteric fever. Typhoid fever is an acute illness which is associated with fever and caused by Salmonella typhi bacteria. It can also be caused by Salmonella paratyphi, a related bacterium that usually causes a less severe illness. Its incubation period is 10 to 14 days. Then causes of typhoid fever. Here causative organism for typhoid fever is Salmonella typhi from family Enterobacteriaceae. It is a gram negative bacilli, best grows at 37 degrees Celsius. Then the transmission of typhoid fever. Typhoid fever can be transmitted through fecal-oral route, close contact with patient or carriers, and it can be transmitted through contaminated water and food. Then investigation for typhoid fever. In first week, first we do blood culture. On second week, we start antibiotic therapy and also do Vidal test. Okay, then stool culture can be done in third week and urine culture can be done in fourth week. Then prescription for typhoid fever. For typhoid fever, we give tablet ciprofloxacin 500 mg twice daily for 14 days along with tablet paracetamol 500 mg 3 times daily till fever subside. So here for the treatment of typhoid fever, we can also give other alternative drug like cefixime 200 mg twice daily or ceftriaxone can be given in typhoid fever. Okay, so drug of choice for typhoid fever is ciprofloxacin. It is a fluoroquinolone group of antibiotic, and alternative drugs are cefixime and ceftriaxone. Both are cephalosporin. Now coming to a CCR, an 8 years old boy came with complaint of toothache since 3 days. On the examination, general practitioner has diagnosed it as a dental caries, started the treatment and referred to the dentist. On examination, the diagnosis was uncomplicated dental caries. The general practitioner prescribed tablet ciprofloxacin 250 mg twice daily for 5 days, tablet metronidazole 200 mg 3 times daily for 5 days, tablet nimesulide 50 mg twice daily for 5 days. Is the above prescription correct? State the reason for your answer. Rewrite the above prescription in correct and proper way. So here this is the incorrect prescription. Okay, here an 8 year old boy came with chief complaint of toothache since 3 days. On the examination, general practitioner diagnosed with dental caries, and he was prescribed tablet ciprofloxacin, tablet metronidazole and tablet nimesulide. Okay, and after on the examination, he was diagnosed with uncomplicated dental caries. So here tablet ciprofloxacin, it is a fluoroquinolone group of antibiotic. Okay, it is a correct drug for dental caries, but in children it should be avoided because it can cause cartilage damage in wet bearing joints in young experimental animals. That's why it should be avoided in children. Here instead of ciprofloxacin, we can give amoxicillin 250 mg capsule 3 times daily. Okay, and this amoxicillin, it is a extended spectrum penicillin. It has it is active against streptococci and lactobacilli. Okay, so here ciprofloxacin should be avoided in children because it can cause cartilage damage. Okay, then tablet metronidazole. Tablet metronidazole, it is an anti-amoebic drug. It is used to cover anaerobic microorganism. Okay, it can be used in dental caries, complicated dental caries. But here it is a case of uncomplicated dental caries. So here we can omit the metronidazole. Okay, there is no need to add metronidazole. Okay, because it is a case of uncomplicated dental caries, and metronidazole, it is used for complicated dental caries. Then tablet nimesulide. Tablet nimesulide, it is a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. It inhibits preferential COX-2 enzyme. Okay, but it should be avoided in children because it can cause hematuria. This will lead to renal damage in children. That's why it should be avoided. Instead of nimesulide, we can give paracetamol 250 mg or ibuprofen 200 mg. Okay, so this is a incorrect prescription. Instead of ciprofloxacin, we can give tablet amoxicillin 250 mg 3 times daily. Okay, and then for here we omit tablet metronidazole, and instead of nimesulide we can give tablet paracetamol 250 mg. This is the correct prescription. Now the answer is, ciprofloxacin is a fluoroquinolone antibiotic which act by inhibiting DNA gyrase and topoisomerase 4 enzyme required for bacterial DNA synthesis. It is surely a correct drug used for dental caries in adult patients, but it has caused cartilage damage in wet bearing joints in young experimental animals. So it is prudent to avoid use of ciprofloxacin in children. Use of ampicillin 250 mg 3 times daily as a common offending organism. Streptococci and lactobacilli are sensitive to it, and it does not cause diarrhea as a complication which is seen with ampicillin. Next point is, metronidazole is used to cover anaerobic microorganism which are common with periodontal infection and apical involvement in dental caries complicated. So it may be used at a dose of 200 mg 3 times daily, but omission of metronidazole will not affect the outcome much as it is a case of uncomplicated dental caries. Then third point is, nimesulide is a preferential COX-2 inhibitor in children. It has been found to cause hematuria as a result of renal damage. So it is better not to give in children. Paracetamol 250 mg or ibuprofen 200 mg afford good symptomatic relief from pain and take twice or thrice a day. Next point is, patient is old enough to take solid dosage form, so liquid syrup may not be prescribed. This is a correct prescription for dental caries in children. Correct prescription is capsule amoxicillin 250 mg 3 times daily for 5 days along with tablet paracetamol 250 mg 2 times daily for 5 days. Thank you.